Mr. and Mrs. North, starring Barbara Britton and Richard Denning.
Van Winkle slept so long, I'm surprised he ever woke up.
Old Rip slept in the Catskills, darling, not the Adirondacks.
Catskills, Adirondacks, what's the difference? Mountains are mountains as far as I'm concerned. Jerry, what are we going to do with these ducks? Poor things. 2 hours ago, they were as happy as could be.
Well, I'll be a lot happier when I see them crisp and juicy on a roasting platter.
But, Jerry, I've never cooked a duck.
I like mine with wild rice, man.
That sounds dangerous.
Hey, what do you know about that?
What?
Avery Arno. I know his sister pretty well. See, what do you say we go in and drop in on him? He used to be a doctor in New York City, but he retired about a year ago.
Dr. Arno, there's a car coming up the driveway.
I thought I told you to put a chain across that road.
I ordered it only yesterday, Doctor.
Well, go see who it is. But remember, I am at home to no one.
Very good, Doctor.
I'll attend to it.
Who is it?
Arlo Collins, Bill Wagon. Remember me? Well, are the Arnos in? We've been hunting in the neighborhood and thought we'd drop by and say hello.
Well, at least they don't have to worry about refrigeration with a character like that around.
Who, Collins? No, he's a patient of the doctor, a mental case of some sort. He's devoted to the Arnos.
Bill Wagon!
Well, Ellen, hello. It's been a long time, hasn't it?
I should say.
May I present Mr. and Mrs. North, Miss Arno.
How do you do? Well, what on earth brings you way up here?
Show her, Jerry.
Oh, those poor, skinny little creatures. Aren't you ashamed of yourself? Bill tells me you have a wonderful recipe for wild ducks, Miss Arno. Could I have it framed, maybe? Of course, Mrs. North. Oh, Collins, would you put the ducks on ice, please?
Very well, Miss Arno.
Won't you come into the living room? Sure. Of course, you have to hang them first.
Who?
The ducks.
Oh.
Then you rub them inside with salt. I'm not being a very good hostess, am I? Bill, would you help me with the cocktail things?
I'd be delighted to, Ellen.
We'll be right back. Hang them and salt them. That recipe sort of goes with a creepy place like this, Jerry. I have a feeling there's something going on.
Yeah, it is kind of weird, isn't it? Maybe we ought to take the ducks and get out of here. Ellen, things like that don't happen, not in this day and age.
You've known me for years. You know I'm not the hysterical type. I tell you, there's no question about it.
A homicidal maniac, Ellen?
Yes, in this house. Bill, it's awful. It's terrifying.
Look, Ellen, you need to calm down.
How can I? Just now, as I came down the stairs, I saw the shadow of a man running toward the driveway.
Okay, Ellen. I'll have a look.
Good. I'll get the cocktail things.
Then you really believe there is a maniac loose around here?
Somebody took our shotguns out of the car. And just on a hunch, I tried the motor. It's been tampered with.
Well, apparently someone wants us to stay around for a while. Is that it?
Or that they don't want us to leave tonight.
Avery, I can't stand this any longer. I'll go mad myself. Stark, raving mad.
You know my feelings, Ellen. I can do nothing about it.
Be reasonable. Living here under these conditions is like living in a perpetual nightmare. Or do you want me to leave you?
Good heavens, no. You're my sister. I need you. You know that. Both of you.
It's like Ellen. I'm nearing a breaking point.
We've been all through this before, and you know the answer. Dr. Eckner here yet?
He's waiting for you in the study. But this is my last night in this house, Doctor. That's final.
Well, what about your friend, Dr. Arno? Doesn't he have a car? It's in the village for repairs. At least that's what the butler said.
Phil, I don't like this whole setup. And Pam doesn't either. After all, the Arnos are complete strangers to us.
I know, Jerry. And I'm sorry I put you in a spot.
After you hang them and salt them, I wonder what you do.
With what?
The ducks.
Open the door, will you? I have a train on it.
Sorry to have been so long. Now, what does who like to drink and who wants one jigger or two?
Well, I'll mix pans if you don't mind, Miss Arno. She likes charged water with a cork dipped into it exactly 1/2 second.
Miss Arno, would you think it terribly rude of us if we phoned for a cab? You see, Jerry is a book publisher, and there's an author in from the coast for just one night in New York.
Mrs. North, there isn't a cab within 50 miles. And in any event, you couldn't phone... I tried the phone just now, and I couldn't even raise the operator. Bill, will you see if the line is clear?
All right. It's dead now.
It was working all right before you arrived.
I didn't get your order, Miss Arno.
Oh, nothing for me, thanks. Won't you all sit down, please? Do you mind? Thank you. I'm dreadfully sorry that you seem to be prisoners here. Bill, you've told Mr. and Mrs. North about our problem.
Mm-hmm. He said that you were afraid of something in the house.
Yes. For a long time, we've heard strange sounds. Florence Earle, that's my brother's secretary and nurse. She's heard them, so is my brother. It comes at odd hours.
What sort of sounds?
Oh, unearthly cries. Just like a man in utter anguish.
Go on, Miss Arno.
Well, lately, odd physical things have been happening, too. Just like that phone.
And the guns that were taken out of your car, Bill.
Bill, has he been prowling in your car? Well, coupled with the phone, that means...
You're right, Miss Arno. With your car unavailable and Bill's crippled and no possible communication to or from the house, that must mean that tonight's a night for someone to... Maybe us.
Well, have you any idea as to the identity of this creature?
Well, after a fashion. I was looking in my brother's desk for a checkbook, and I came upon a case history of a patient. There it was in my brother's handwriting. Patient X, the homicidal maniac, is in this house.
Why haven't you given this matter to the police?
Well, my brother regards his patients as his children. He will not have him turned over to the police.
But if this one is dangerous...
He still thinks he can effect a cure. That's why Dr. Eckner is coming here. You'll meet him at dinner. He's a very old friend and authority on mental cases. I'll be a mental case myself if this isn't cleared up tonight.
Upstairs. Do you think we were overheard?
Collins, you see my sister?
She's in the living room, Doctor, with your guests.
Ellen, you all right?
Yes, dear, quite all right.
Seemed to come from right outside my lab door. Yeah, when I opened it, there was no one there. I've searched the attic and the upper floors.
Avery, this is Mr. and Mrs. North.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And you remember Bill Wigand?
Oh, yes. Hello, Bill. Happy to have you aboard.
Hello, Doctor.
Excuse me, Dr. Arno. Dr. Eckner is waiting for you in your study.
Oh, thank you.
Avery,
excuse me.
Don't become involved. Dinner's practically on the table.
Oh, I shan't be a minute. Excuse me.
Did you hear him shriek?
Yes, dear, but don't worry. Tonight will see an end to this.
It certainly will for me. I'm leaving.
You can't. You mustn't. Meet Mr. and Mrs. North. And Lieutenant Bill Wigand, this is Florence Earle, my brother's secretary and nurse.
How do you do, Mr. and Mrs. North? Lieutenant.
Hello.
How do you
do? I'm sorry, Ellen. I've arranged for a car. I'm leaving right after dinner.
We at Hampstead University believe in facing such issues squarely. We take one fact for granted. Homicidal mania can be brought to its climax, or to its cure, for that matter, by only one means. Actual homicide.
Or simulated homicide. Now, actual homicide is out of the question. Not to speak about it being unlawful. So I propose simulated homicide. In this house. Tonight.
Darling, wouldn't things be less complicated if only you weren't so stubborn in this matter?
I've told you, Ellen.
But doesn't it seem childish to protect the identity of a patient whose condition your own notes say is utterly hopeless?
Nothing is hopeless. Forgive me for saying so, Doctor, but when one word from you could save your sister so much needless anxiety...
I'm afraid you don't understand, Mr. North. No power on earth could compel me to betray this unfortunate soul.
But you say yourself the man is mad.
At the moment, yes. But I still have hopes of effecting a cure.
Well, you see, although his own life is in danger, he is still an optimist. Now, we are six sane people against one who is insane. I say give Patient X a chance to put in an appearance. Are you there, Patient X?
Hans, I wish you'd let me handle this matter in my own way.
Your way? How long have I heard that?
Lawrence!
Dr. Eckner, what makes you think you can bring Patient X out into the open?
A homicidal maniac is primarily an extrovert whose neuroses have taken over control of his body and soul. He will react to a simulated murder as if it were one of his own accomplishments.
You mean if we stage a phony murder, Patient X will want to take credit for it?
Exactly. Now, if no one has any objection, I suggest we proceed. Ladies and gentlemen, I take your silence as assent. I warn you, Avery, I intend to expose you, Patient X. If you refuse to save yourself, I think it's time that we, your friends, save you for us.
Whatever you say, Hans.
You would please write on six slips of paper the following.
Just a minute. There's someone listening behind that door.
Enter! Enter, Patient X! Collins.
Excuse me, Doctor. I hesitated to interrupt.
Welcome. Well, you are part of this household. You will take part in this game. Make it seven slips, please. On five, you write, please, with a single word, suspect. On the sixth, write murderer. And on the seventh, victim.
Very well.
Is this going to be like a seance or something?
No, there will be murder in the living room. Simulated murder. Will you please pass out the slips now? Now, when the lights come on again in the living room, I will question you, insult you, confuse you. But during the time of questioning, you may be sure of one thing. I will compel Avery's patient X to put in an appearance. Shall we go? I will play the piano. You will mill here and there. All the while, my music will stimulate the confused nerves of a potential murderer. Now, when I say kill, whoever among you has the slip reading victim will crumple to the floor.
If Patient X arrives, I'll take charge. You see what I meant about police interference?
You're not going to use your gun, Lieutenant, or your authority. With the appearance of Patient X, Dr. Arno and I will take complete charge.
Well, it'd be quite a pleasure, eh, Jerry?
As is customary in such cases, patient X will want to confess. The urge to confess is a primary emotion in homicidal paranoia. He would say that he killed the victim. Where is the master switch that controls the lighting in this room?
It's right here, Dr. Eichner.
Oh, thank you. Very well, then. And so begins our little game.
What do you think of this?
I'll give you three guesses.
Very well, Collins. Darkness, if you please. Proceed. The game has begun. An evening for murder, patient X. How can you resist? Come out. Come out of the darkness, patient X. Strike. Borgias did it with poison. The phantoms of Paris with a strangler's noose. How are you going to do it, patient X? Kill! Kill! Let no one move! Who killed that woman? You! You did it! I will tell you your motive. You met her in New York, at Octano's office. You were fascinated by her beauty. And at the first meeting, you learned...
Just a moment, Dr. Eichner. This is no longer a game. It's the real thing. This woman is dead.
But This is impossible.
Stabbed?
But, Avery, isn't there something we can do?
I'm afraid not. She died instantly.
But... why was Florence singled out?
Well, the only conclusion I can reach is that patient X must have slipped into this room. Took part in the game. And when he'd selected this victim, struck.
Dr. Rano, do you still plan to conceal the identity of patient X even after what's happened here tonight?
No. Time's come for me to tell all I know. Patient X is a man called Hubert Farrar. Under that name, I've treated him for many years. Under that name, he was admitted to the Naval Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland, just a year ago, where my diagnosis of a pressure on the brain was confirmed.
Hubert Farrar.
Yes? Yes, this is 3434. Would you repeat that, please? Very well, thank you. A telephone repairman checking the line. All phones in this area have been out of order since early this evening. A fallen tree.
Well, then it wasn't patient X who severed our communications. Oh, Collins. Why don't you try the doorbell? It may work now. Then all we need to find are the missing shotguns.
And a distributor cap from my car.
And patient X.
Say, what are you two up to?
Bill, we found this in Miss Earle's room.
Oh.
To whom it may concern. I leave this house tonight, but I want it known that I fear for my life. Secure the details from Dr. Arno or his beloved patient X.
Well, if Arno knows anything, it certainly isn't in his files. There's nothing on Hubert Farrar or patient X.
Say, here's something. Take a look at that.
Hubert Farrar. Well, it's a lead, all right.
What's more than that, Bill? Why not call Baltimore, the Naval Hospital, see what they have on the patient,
all
Hubert
right,
Farrar?
I'll do that. Hello. Hello, operator. I'd like to speak to the Naval Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland, please. Yes, I'll hang on. This is 3434, Dr. Avery Arno. Yes, it's urgent, please.
is this the Naval Hospital at Baltimore? I'd like to speak to the registrar, please. Hello, registrar? This is Lieutenant Weigum, New York Police. I'd like to check the record of a patient. Yes, well, he's there for a diagnosis approximately a year ago. Yes, his name is Hubert Farrar. F-A-R-R-A-R. His doctor's name is Avery Arno.
Sure you don't mean Dr. Farrar? What? He's in surgery, but I'll try and locate him for you.
Jerry, Bill, look at this.
We're getting no place, no place. Did you find anything?
We were in Dr. Arno's lab. Very interesting. You know, Dr. Eckner, your little game, despite the fact that it backfired here tonight, has merit. But I suggest that we carry it out a step further.
For instance?
Pam, will you take over the piano department? We'll play the little game all over again. Who knows? Maybe patient X will come out of the woodwork.
Wasn't that lucky? Now, who would be in charge of the silverware? Well, the butler, of course.
All right, you win. I killed Florence Earle.
Collins? Oh, that's very commendable, Collins, but you're not telling the truth. Dr. Arno is the murderer. How dare you, Mrs. North? Miss Arno, your brother is patient X.
Oh, utterly ridiculous.
Avery is very sick, Ellen. Since boyhood, he's had a Jekyll and Hyde complex.
How can you presume a thing like that?
In his confusion tonight, he made a slip of the tongue and named Hubert Farrar as patient X. Hubert Farrar's a naval doctor, an old friend of your brother's. He told us on the phone the whole history of the case.
He warned your brother over a year ago that he had a pressure on the brain.
Doctor, say this isn't true.
Oh, now I see. He killed Florence Earle because she planned to expose him. Oh, he's hopelessly mixed up. Jekyll and Hyde, that explains it.
You knew about it too, Collins. That's why you took the guns from the car.
He did it to protect me. I'm sorry, Ellen. I'm afraid it's all true. These are going to be the saddest words of my life. I thought I was cured. Until tonight, I was certain of it. And then something snapped, just as it had before. I didn't want to kill Florence. I don't even remember doing it. I know I did. Oh, I fought it and fought it. This is no good. It's like a black cloud suddenly coming out of a clear sky. There have been many perfectly lucid moments since I moved up here to the country. Long periods when I had the slightest desire to kill or destroy. The isolation seemed to help. I guess it was only temporary. It's hopeless. There are moments when I know I'm completely insane.
Oh, Avery. Avery!
Doctor, I think you better take care of your friend.
But the murder of Florence Earle.
I think the verdict will be not guilty by reason of insanity.
Boy, am I glad that one's over.
You can say that again. You know, with that Dr. Arno running around loose, we could have all been dead ducks.
Ducks! Ducks!
What?
We've got to go back. Our ducks are in their icebox.
Just forget it, darling. We can buy some in town.
But that won't help.
Why?
Because Ellen never finished telling me the recipe. She only got as far as the salt and pepper, and then Florence was murdered, and surely a duck needs more seasoning than that.
Shall I turn around?
Do, and there'll be another dead duck.
Thank you.
and Mrs. North is directed by Ralph Francis Murphy. A John W. Loveton production. Produced by Federal Telefilms. Starring Barbara Britton and Richard Denning, featuring Francis DeSales. This has been a film presentation.